Well, hey everybody, it's Lisa back, and this is Lisa from True North Homeschool Academy. I'm here with Meredith Curtis. Hey, Meredith, so glad you're
Hi,
here.
thanks for having me on.
I'm so glad you're here. We did a recording on mysteries because you teach a whodunit class, which is about cozy mysteries and writing a novel.
Yes.
But you teach a lot of history classes for True North too, and I love that you have such an interesting way of explaining history, and you're just passionate about history. And having a teacher who just is in love with the subject matter can make all the difference. So tell us what you teach and as far as history goes, and what do you want to talk about today with history?
Well, thank you for asking. I do love history. I love history because it's God's story. He created the earth. He filled it with people. He destroyed the earth in the flood. And then, but from the first time that mankind sinned, had the promise of Jesus, and all of history points either forward to him or back to him. And he is intricately involved in everything that happens. And I love that. I love, love, love that. And I love the way that in the midst of things that are going horribly wrong, you can see God still moving and still rescuing people and still with these people that are so ordinary, and he uses them in such extraordinary ways. So I get so excited about history. And yes, sometimes when I'm reading stories to my kids, I start to cry because it's so touching. But yes, I was hoping we could talk about 20th century history today, because I'm actually teaching two classes that are 20th century history, and we use the same textbook. This is the textbook, History of the 20th Century. It's very big, but it's very easy to understand. And then there's a middle school workbook and high school workbook. So we have a high school class and a middle school class. And we just take history of the 1900s, decade by decade by decade by decade throughout the whole thing. And honestly, Lisa, the reason I teach this class, the reason I wrote the book, is because when I went looking for a 20th century history book, I could not find one that wasn't, for a better word, woke. I couldn't find one that taught what really happened. I lived through 40 years of the 20th century. And I was like, this is not what happened.
I was there.
So I just was like, I have to teach kids the truth, because this is just what just happened. Right. And I remember growing up, and my parents had been so impacted by World War I because they had lived through it as children. And I felt like they constantly talked to me about things that happened during World War I, and it impacted them. But I don't feel like this generation has an accurate picture of what happened in the 20th century. So I really have a heartbeat for that century. And I really, I love to teach it, and I love to talk about it. So is that okay if we talk about the 20th century?
I just want to pause for a minute and talk about why it's so important for our kids to understand the 20th century, because I think it might just be like, we can just look at whatever, but it set the stage for the last 20 years and what's coming. And we are, I say this so often, we're in the fourth industrial revolution. And the reading and research that I've done recently has been, I was talking with my kids about this because we watched a movie over break. In the 1910s, well, 1890s to 1910s, that was the industrial revolution I learned about in eighth grade. So I thought there was one, right? But at the end of that time, you now have the modern era. We went from like a pre-modern to a modern era, but this industrial revolution we're in now, it has so much to do with tech. And the research I've been doing right now is saying, we're not going to get to the end of it where it's just like, okay, now we're in this postmodern or highly tech world. We're just in a time of disruption and change, and it's not going to end anytime soon. And so I think it's really valuable for our kids to understand the last century, what went into making the world that they live in now, and how they can respond to it, because they have so much coming at them from every direction. The phone, there's so much electronic stuff coming at them, and knowing where you came from helps you know how to have feet firmly planted so you can stand. And for me, that's really like my hope for our kids is they can be found standing at the end, right? That exactly. They don't fall to so much. And again, they have so many challenges coming at them. So we need to equip them really well. So I just want to throw that out there.
No, I agree. And you know, one of the things that I tell my kids all the time, my grandchildren, my children, I grew up in a time where on Sunday mornings, nothing was open. Everyone was in church.
The blue laws.
And there's, you know, and you didn't go shopping on Sunday because everyone was in church and then they were with their family.
Yeah.
And I remember the first divorce I heard of was in high school. I didn't know people getting divorces.
Right.
And I want my children to know and my grandchildren to know this was normal for hundreds of years in America. Like people stayed married.
Right.
Yes, there was the occasional divorce. There was the occasional baby born out of wedlock, but people living together was unheard of.
Right.
And it was so just morally, there's such a breakdown in virtue and morality. And, you know, I feel like there's some Christians who look me in the eye and say, well, I didn't know living together was wrong. I mean, I'm not doing this. And I'm thinking, what? And that this is genuinely going on in our culture. So morally, I want to introduce them to, you know, what life was like, mm-hmm. and then how the morals began to shift, especially when it became legal to kill unborn babies.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to talk to them about, and I remember Christians being willing to be arrested to protest abortion. I had friends that went to jail, and I want to teach them about things like that. Yeah. I want to teach them about the woman whose court case went to the Supreme Court and it was all a lie.
Yeah.
And what really happened in that situation. So then that's a whole moral thing.
Right.
But then look at how our culture changed in the 20th century. Like you said, it started out on the farm. Everyone lived on a farm.
Everyone.
Yeah, there were cities, but the majority of people lived on the family farm that met their own needs. And then with what was extra, they sold it.
Yeah.
Now, I mean, Bill Gates owns a lot of the farmland across America now, and there's huge industrial farms, and we've lost that family farm. I love that my cousin, Steve, has our old family farm.
Yeah.
My daddy grew up on a farm. My grandmother grew up on a farm. And then the whole migration to the city. Mm-hmm. City life is so completely different from country life.
Yeah.
And kids need to learn like what was normal and to see the migration of how people were graduating. Now it does go back to the 1800s, not migration, but still we started out the century with a lot of people living on farms.
Right.
And you mentioned this in our last podcast.
Yeah.
The airplane was invented. Yes. You know, the little glider, like you know, with the engine, but by World War I, pilots are dropping bombs from their plane. It's and crazy. By 1919, there is an airline and that would be, what is that? The Dutch airline, KLM. Airlines.
Wow, they were the first.
They were the first. There were two. One is no longer existent, but KLM is still there. And then we have the space race and we have landing a man on the moon. But why did it take so long from the space race, from the invention of rockets that go up in the air to get to a place where it's a business? In the early 1900s, it was less than 10 years, 20 years. And then what you also see is you see the influence of socialism, of communism, and you see the changes that brought. Yeah. Most people don't know that after that Germany, the Kaiser, gave Lenin a little ride through Germany to get to Russia to stir up trouble to end World War I, or he hoped, and that problem of the Eastern Front. But with the Russian Revolution, most people don't know every single communist leader in the 1900s was trained in Russia.
Wow.
But many of them became socialists, communists on college campuses. Ho Chi Minh became a communist at the, in University of Paris. That may not be the name of the, but in Paris at a college. Then he went to Russia and was trained how to overthrow his nation. They had a school there. Lisa, you don't read that in textbooks.
No, you don't.
You don't read about the Jews coming back to Israel. And that Hitler said to the world, if anyone will take the Jews, they can have them. And you know what? There were only two nations who said without reservation, any Jews that want to come can come. Mm-hmm. And that was the Netherlands and that was Denmark. And they were both overrun by Hitler very quickly.
Wow.
There's so many things that happened in the 1900s that we need to be afraid of.
History is so informative. And I don't know if you understand your history. If you don't, you're bound to repeat it. I think we're bound to repeat it anyway because of human nature.
Absolutely.
But I do think understanding it gives us both, it's a warning and it gives us hope. I think it's both and, it's not either or. I think understanding history helps us realize where were the wins and why were they wins and how can we emulate that? I mean, you and I, when we talk, we always bring up Corrie Ten Boom, I feel like, because she's such an amazing woman of God, small but fierce. And I think we can really learn from that. Did she do anything extraordinary? Yes. She didn't quit.
And you know what? I include a lot about her in my book and also in Denmark. Do you know that when Hitler was invading Denmark, they got every Jew out?
Wow.
There was only a handful, not every, there's only a handful left. Yeah. The whole nation worked together and got the Jews out.
Yeah.
So there's so many heroes that we don't hear about.
Right.
And it's so important.
And it's so encouraging. Well, it's so encouraging because we can look at that and our kids can look at that and go, they didn't quit. I can still keep going, you know, because if they could do it, I could do it. We can borrow that courage for ourselves when things get tough. And I feel like we are in this time of disruption where jobs are changing, new jobs are being created. We're hearing a lot about AI, how it's going to kill the essay. And I'm like, I don't think so, but not on my watch. That's my rallying cry this year. No, the essay continues. But I do feel like our kids really just need to be equipped with some courage.
I agree.
And understanding history really gives them that. It's a very simple tool to hand courage to them with. And you are really going, I love that you're going decade by decade. Because there's so much packed into each decade last century.
There is.
Yeah.
There is so much packed in there. And one thing I do when I teach history is I don't just focus on political leaders and wars and things like that, which we do cover. But my kids learn that during World War II, they invented M&Ms because they wanted the soldiers to have chocolate and they created the candy coating so it doesn't melt. Of course, we all know that M&Ms melt at high temperatures in the Florida sun. I've discovered that.
They're safe in South Dakota right now. Let me just say that.
Yes. But so we learn about things like movies and books that were written and songs that were popular. And we listen to songs and artwork, you know, there's some artwork to speak of. It's not like the greatest century for artwork, but we talk about fashion and we look at how the fashions have changed and we talk about foods that were popular and things like that and sports. And we talk about the first Super Bowl and the first World Cup, because here is the bottom line: in the midst of even the most tumultuous situation, people fall in love, get married, raise children, decide if they're going to serve the Lord or not, plant a garden in the backyard. They do life.
Yeah.
And there's so much about just little things that we don't think anything of now that they weren't always there. You know, there wasn't always a World Cup.
Yeah.
My son-in-law is from Ecuador and he's still in the World Cup. And there wasn't always a Super Bowl, and there, you know, and so it's it is history to me is I want to take my kids in a time machine back to one or more decades in the 20th century and say, look around, this is what life is like. If you were shopping in the store, this is, you know, what you would buy. If you would, you know, if it's the turn of the 19th century, then 1900s, then you would go to a soda shop and you would see this health drink called Coke. No, not it was, that was a little bit later, but you would see this special health drink and your mom would say, oh, have some Coke. It's really good for you. And now it would make your mama turn over in her grave for you to drink.
I love that you talk about food too, because food really goes in and out of style, doesn't it? I mean,
yes,
wow. And new candies and desserts and things. I mean, very interesting. I love that you bring that aspect into it in sports. So you're really giving kids a well-rounded look at every decade. And that's, I mean, every decade has its own like defining moment or whatever, but also theme. And so that's really a fun way to look at history. Do they do a timeline in your class?
They do. They do a timeline at the beginning of every decade. And then there is an optional for extra credit book and movie. So if they watch a movie, they get extra points toward their grade. Now, I don't do tests in my class, and I might change that, but I really focus more on projects. So they do a lot of hands-on projects. So they do the timeline, and I really encourage them, do your timeline while you watch a movie set in that decade. You know, that gives you that some extra credit. And but also they do things like this semester they're going to design an amusement park, because amusement parks became really popular in the 20th century. There's the golden age of airlines in the 1950s, which we'll be talking about in a couple weeks. They're going to design an airline, and they're going to create in class, we're going to divide up into some groups, and they're going to create a commercial for their airline. They're going to, you know, design an airport, and we're going to, and a suburb, because suburbs became really popular in the 1950s. So they're going to create their own suburb and they're going to turn them in, and then we're going to share them. And I'm going to put them in my PowerPoint, show off all the suburbs. And that is, people can think, oh, well, that's not, you know, studious work, but they're going to remember that they designed a suburb and they planned a trip across Route 66.
Right.
And that is related to the 1950s. Mm-hmm. And why we talked about this in my geography class just recently, but we're going to do it again in my history class. Why did they design the interstate system?
Yeah.
Because Eisenhower, and well, people before him, but he really drove it home, is so impressed with the Autobahn. It gave Hitler such an advantage. So the interstate system is actually designed for soldiers to be able to get their supplies and men to strategic places.
Wow.
And if you notice, the roads are numbered.
Yes.
The even and then the odd, they're numbered low to high.
Yeah.
And from the west, low to high to the east. So all that stuff, a lot of kids don't know. And it's very interesting to them, because it's not the typical, okay, this guy got angry, he sent all his young men to die. And, it can be sad. And World War One and World War Two are very sad.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I tell the kids before we start, I'm like, you're going to be really sad when I tell you this. Eugenics was very popular. And honestly, I teach my kids about eugenics because eugenics is popular again this year.
It is.
They don't call it eugenics, but it's the same thing.
Well, and Planned Parenthood is based on Margaret Sanger's eugenics ideology. Exactly. So, and it's actually working, because she really wanted to target the Black community, and the Black community has been devastated by abortion. So her vision has come to fruition in many ways. I think it's really important for our kids to understand that, you know, the power of vision. And I mean, Eisenhower's vision, I had no idea that the roads were put in place because of Hitler's thought. So what a great gift. I mean, we've gone coast to coast, north to south, east to west on these beautiful highways. Thank you, Hitler. I mean,
well, we don't think
him. No, we don't think Hitler. But I mean, it's just interesting how even out of really tragedy, so many great things can come.
Another thing that Hitler did that people don't really realize he did is that there was a physicist named Robert Goddard, and mm-hmm. Robert Goddard experimented a lot with rocketry, but we really never did anything with them. Well, Hitler took all of the work that he did, and he got his scientists working on it, mm-hmm. and they developed, you know, these rocket bombs, and they used all, when they ended up, the scientists who created the bombs for Hitler ended up defecting to the United States. And yeah. one of them, Wernher von Braun, became head of our space department. And we talked about the kids with them. And I just asked them, because he actually did become a Christian. But I said, what do you guys think of this? Like, should we have done, you know? But anyway, he said, they said to him, how did you get all this technology? How did the Nazis, and they're like, from Robert Goddard, you know, American Robert Goddard. So it's so many things that, you know, technology can be used for good or evil. Robert Goddard would have never wanted it the way Hitler was.
Yeah.
But eventually we did use it for good in the space shuttle and things like that.
Yeah. Interesting. Well, this class sounds so much like so much fun. I love studying centuries by decades, because again, you just see the themes and how they're all connected, and it's so cool. And I love that you're doing people, places, sports, food, fashion, some art, music.
Yes.
I love it. I think there's so much value too, to just think about, like you mentioned, suburbs, because it really shows the shift in society from agrarian to and urban to there's this whole suburb kind of situation that just grew up. And nobody had heard of suburbs before. They didn't exist before. Now they're such an important part of our world, really.
Well, and that's kind of interesting that you said that, because when the train started going through in London, the little towns would spring up around the train. And those builders would come in and they would build these little, they called them, you know, railroad towns. And then in the 1950s, that kind of just blossomed like crazy. Yeah. And we got all these suburbs. But it's just very interesting that they are, they're such a part of our life. Like, everyone wants to live in the suburbs. People, like, some people want to live in the country and off the land, but most people just want to live in the suburbs. Yeah. And that became a thing in the 1950s, and it's very interesting to see how similar suburbs today are to those model suburbs in the 1950s. It really hasn't changed that much. You know, now we have two cars instead of one, but you see moms out walking their babies, and you know, the dog in
the yard, the designer dog. I mean, okay, so this, I think this is going to be a really fun and exciting class for kids. And it's very project-based. So if your kids are intimidated by just learning dry, boring history facts, they're going to learn exciting, scintillating history facts. And it's going to be a project-based assessment way to learn, which is really kind of unique and fun. And again, our classes are designed to be small group and interactive and dynamic, so that they can get that interaction with other students and the teacher. They present their projects to their fellow students.
Yes.
They read their papers out loud. That's how we've designed the classes. So we like to say we use cutting edge, or we use time-tested educational pedagogy with cutting edge technology.
Yes.
And I think we do a good job of integrating those. You also do a great job of using your topic boards in your virtual classroom.
Thank you.
Yeah, you just create so many extended learning opportunities for your students. And that's one of the great things I love about our online community, is every class is like a virtual classroom. So the kids get in there, they see their syllabus, they see notes from the teacher, gradebook, assignment center, and then there's topic boards and bulletin boards for them to like just really dig in deep. And extra credit, some of the teachers have just gone ahead and baked that right into the class, because we always have those kids who want to go above and beyond.
Yeah, and you know, one of the things I especially notice in my junior high class, they want to go on rabbit trails. They investigate things at home, both I think they don't feel as much pressure as the high schoolers.
Yeah.
And so I noticed that, you know, like the high schoolers are more thinking toward college, but I noticed that my junior highers in my geography class and in my history, 20th century history class, they're always telling me, oh yeah, I looked up this and
we'll
talk about something. And I just get so excited because, you know, they don't, like I said, they don't feel that pressure. They're not having a part-time job yet. Yeah. And they're so excited to learn stuff like that. And I think, you know, a lot of times when I'm teaching, I'll say, well, if you're more interested in this, it would be fun to find out blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
And give them that, you know, kind of a, you know, some kids love to learn, but we, you know, when you try to teach so many things, like some girls' faces really light up when we talk about fashion, some boys' faces light up when we talk about sports, and, or medicine, or in, you know, like penicillin was invented and, insulin created. Yeah. So all of those things are interesting for someone who wants to be a doctor. You know, they want, they kind of perk up like, oh wow, that was really cool. That's how penicillin was invented. And so anyway, there's just so much fun to learn history that way, because my hope is that these kids will grow up and they will love to learn.
Yeah.
And they'll be excited and they'll say, oh wow, you know, this is weather geography, because it's the coldest Christmas ever. You know, we just had such a cold Christmas. And I send a letter and I'm like, this is geography. Make sure you write down what your temperature is and we can all talk about it when we get back. Because that is life. Life is full of things to learn about and things that are interesting. And if you have a desire to learn, it makes life more fun and more interesting.
It does. Yeah. It does. And I love how even just bringing in so many new things, because I think that's one of actually the real, hopefully purposes of junior high and high school, is to give our kids a broad breadth of just a smorgasbord of learning and ideas. So they can grab onto the things that are of interest to them and, you know, follow those budding trails, because you never know, maybe learning about penicillin in seventh grade is going to take them on the path of being a doctor who creates the next fact, you know, I don't want to say that word, but the next penicillin.
Yeah, we don't want to go there.
We don't want to go there. But yeah, I think that's really exciting. And this class really covers a wide variety of different, interests and can really get the kids excited about learning and just moving on as they go into high school and what to learn then. So you're teaching 20th century history for junior high, specifically for junior high. There's a specific workbook for it. And then 20th century high school, and it's a full high school credit. And there's a separate workbook for that.
Absolutely. Yeah. That's what we're doing. And this is actually the workbook for it. And the one for high school is black. Mm-hmm. And you notice it looks a lot like the textbook. So they can find their books easily.
Yeah. Well, I'll put the links to it too. You're also teaching. I'm not going to get it all straight. So hopefully you'll remember. You're also teaching a full credit of health class for high school, which is a great science class for those kids who don't really want to go into maybe academic science, but really need another science credit. This health class is going to cover a wide variety of health issues and give them some solid life skills and be a full credit of science.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And that is a very practical class. Yes, we do go through all the body systems, but we talk far beyond. Yeah. We talk mainly about, okay, so this is the respiratory system. Yeah. Now, how can you keep your respiratory system healthy? We talk about, you know, ways to expand your lung capacity and why that impacts singers and why that impacts scuba divers and things like that. And so we talk about nutrition through the whole year and certain minerals and vitamins and things that are helpful in that. And then we plan an exercise program. We talk about, you know, planning, we keep a food diary and kind of evaluate, are we getting everything that we need? But we go into other things too. We talk about taking our thoughts captive and lining our thoughts up with the word of God. And we talk about how to choose a friend and what to do with a bully. And So we cover how to have a quiet time.
Yeah.
And so we cover a wide variety of how to stay healthy physically, emotionally, spiritually, and mentally. We even talk about, you know, your learning style and things like that. So
awesome.
It's an all-inclusive class.
Very practical. And we do have a whole section of life skills classes. This fits in really beautifully.
Yes.
With the life skill career exploration, some of those other classes that are really, how do I manage myself in this world that's a little chaotic?
Yeah, it is a little chaotic. Yeah. And that is true.
Other fun project-based science credit. So yeah, I love that your classes are so project-based, because I think it really taps into those kids who might be very intellectual, but just can't write another paper, you know, and these classes, it just gives them a kind of brain break from a more traditionally academic class. And I don't say that these classes aren't academic, because they are very like intellectually oriented, but it's not a traditional academic where they just have to read and study and fill in the blanks for the answers. They're getting their hands a little bit dirty and doing projects and thinking critically about how they're going to present the information they learned. And I love that, because it's just the more neural pathways you can hit to teach your kids, the more they'll remember it, the more they'll integrate it with other knowledge. And it's just it's great learning.
Lisa, I've had so much experience with people studying for tests, getting an A, yeah, and then a year later, not remembering anything.
Yeah.
So my real hope in using projects is that they remember things. And, you know, I always talk to them about through the ages, like think about a lifetime sport. We just talked about that before the break in health. You know, and I talked about people that have lifetime sports and how that impacts them as an older person.
Yeah.
And I believe education is to help us in practical ways in our life, to live a life, a joyful, successful life.
Mm-hmm. I love it. I'm going to list the rest of your classes in the show notes and in the podcast notes. If you guys have any questions for Meredith, you can reach out to her on the Facebook page or let me know and I'll get the message to her. Her students love her. And it's true, because you're so interactive and engaging and you really care for the students, but you're a subject matter expert. And you're really a polymath. You were trained as a nurse and here you are teaching English and history and science, and you're good at it all. And I love that you're a lifelong learner, and you model that for your students too, is that you're just never too old to read that book or learn that skill.
Yeah.
And that is such a great gift to give our kids too, is that, you know, we might have lived through four decades of the last century, but we're still learning tech.
Yes, we are.
Praise God. Praise God. Okay, you guys. Meredith, it's always so fun to talk to you. Thanks for spending time with me today. And you guys, there's two videos and there's two podcasts, Mystery and History. And again, Meredith is teaching at True North Homeschool Academy, live online classes. You can find so many of her curriculum products at Powerline Prod. I will put the link in the show notes. You can find her there too. And she's got great resources on her blog as well as her podcast as well. So I'll link that too.
Thank you so much for having me, Lisa. It's great. And I hope some of your children might be in some of my classes. I would love that.
That'd be awesome. Okay, you guys, we will talk to you soon. Thanks, everybody.
Bye-bye.